love movie and movie discussions, you've come to the right place. Who am I, you ask? I am the Wiz, and I'm here today with...
Zero.
How you doing today?
A bit exhausted since I've got a very, very hellish number of weeks to follow.
Well, when you're a Texas Ranger, it just seems like every week is Hell Week, right? Yeah, I know what you're about. All right, so we are here to review the 2018 animated film by Wes Anderson, Isle of Dogs. The voice is by Bryan Cranston, Edward Norton, Bob Balaban, Jeff Goldblum, and Bill Murray. Zero, we watched one of the first films that we watched when we did this was The French Dispatch, which at the time was the newest film from Wes Anderson. I always thought that if you gave the animated films a chance, you might actually like his stuff a little bit more. When you walked into this before you watched it, what were you thinking about in regards to this?
The Wes Anderson films seem to be on the quirky side of things, so I was like, all right, so I expect this to be quite quirky. And then I was just like, all right, well, animation looks like it's probably going to be stop motion-ish, so don't expect anything like high art anime like Miyazaki, which was fine. It was just more for me to sort of set my own expectations and everything. Overall, I think really the most interesting thing was it's themed with the setting being in Japan, and in the opening sequence, it mentions that some voices will be translated via a narrator, and then the language of the dogs will actually be in, quote, the local language, aka English. So it's kind of this weird mishmash of you've got moments where you've got some characters speaking completely in Japanese and done by Japanese voice actors, and then you've got some moments where someone important might be speaking in Japanese, but you'll have a English narrator literally translating what they say. And then dogs, they're all just sort of speaking in English. So it was a weird design decision, and in my opinion, the moments where you have someone speaking completely in Japanese, it's a little bit sad because there's no subtitles to translate. You just hear this person speaking in Japanese, but in a sense, it's also sort of integral to the plot because you've got some moments where the dogs will say, "Man, I wish I understood what this person was saying." They're speaking in the main country's main language, and I don't quite understand it. With me being a polyglot and having decent-ish comprehension in Japanese, it's interesting because, like, I think a lot of the context would have been great to have subtitling for, and I honestly would feel a bit bad for somebody who's just kind of watching it and going through one of these moments and going, and wow, you know, just, I wonder what he's saying, because some of the dogs seem to think that it's a very important plot point or something.
Yeah, that was one of my big problems with this movie, is that normally I don't mind if they do that, if they have someone in a different language, they don't translate it, because either A, it's not important, or B, the film wants to have you get into the film contextually to figure out what exactly is going on. So normally I don't mind that. But in this film, it did seem really weird that they decided not to actually translate what a lot of the Japanese actors were doing. Or they would be very selective in certain points, correct? Like
they would be selective in certain points where you would have an English narrator basically translating what the Japanese character was saying. So it was very weird, like, hey, this is a pivotal, super important plot point, so we're going to have a person narrating to translate it. But then you also have some moments in another setting where Japanese is being spoken, there's no subtitles, and then you have the dogs basically saying, wow, I wish I understood what this character was saying. And it's just like, that's just such a weird thing to do, but it's Wes Anderson, so I mean, I guess it's part of the quirkiness.
It really isn't, though. That's the thing about Wes Anderson, though, is it's quirky, it's weird, it's kind of quaint and twee. But you definitely understand what's going on. It's just very, it's hard to explain. I want to say forced, but it's not exactly forced. But it's very weird how he does it. But it's understandable. It just seems very unnatural in a lot of sense, in a lot of the movies that he does it. But it's purposely so. All right, let's just go right into the plot. And we're going to do light spoilers on this review. So basically what happens is in the future of Tokyo, dogs develop some kind of flu that is going to infect the humans, and then they decide, let's just put all the dogs into this trash island and have them fend for themselves. A couple years later, a boy named Atari decides to fly to Trash Island to find his beloved dog. This group of five dogs decides to help him find that one dog that he's trying to look for. It would have been really nice to know exactly what the boy was talking about, because the way that he is acting and the way that he sounds in the film makes him seem either way too angry or possibly mentally disturbed. This could be a cultural thing that maybe the way that Japanese people talk, me not understanding it, that's what I'm getting from the body language of it. The other problem is that the boy has something sticking out of his head throughout the entire film that reasonably could have caused him brain damage. But we don't know what the problem is because there's no translation. There's nothing there to gauge that. Now, some would probably say in that end, well, maybe that's up to you to get the visual cues and the way that the character is reacting to things to piece that to yourself. The problem is, I don't think the film does a great job doing that. To me, it was like, I have no idea what to think of this kid. I don't know whether I should feel bad for the kid or be like, you know, screw this kid, I don't care, he's unlikable, because I can't understand him. He was very conflicted on that end. Since you are a polyglot and you probably understand a little bit what he was saying, what was being said in those scenes? Like, was he being abrasive? What was going on?
It was more him being quite impassioned and everything, because okay. like the one moment where he's got the dogs gathered in what essentially is sort of like a makeshift hovel, mm-hmm. he's saying, "Hey, you all are my dogs because I believe that you all are very good boys." And of course, just again, it's one of those scenes where you've got the dogs kind of gathered in. And they're just like, "Man, I wish I understood what he was saying." And it's like, "Damn it! Just why are there no subtitles?" I feel that this would have been an important point to have it subtitled to, you know, show that, you know, he's on this journey to find his beloved dog, and he's going to treat these other dogs with the respect that they deserve. And it's just like, this is such a quirky choice to say, well, yeah, we're not going to subtitle anything Atari says because just reasons. It's just like, this is so freaking frustrating because, like, in a sense, Atari's trying to garner sympathy from the dogs and everything, and some of the dogs are naturally, well, skeptical of him. They're just like, well, humans kind of suck. They threw us on this garbage island and basically said, you know, well, tough luck. We don't want your weird, wacky flu. So if you died, then you died for the human race. So, I mean, it's just a shame, in my opinion, that just some of the Japanese dialogue from Atari is just not even translated whatsoever.
It's frustrating because I don't know the exact reasons to why they did that. If you were going to say, well, we're doing this in perspective of the dogs, then it would make sense that you would see subtitles or interpretations from scenes that the dogs are not even there. For like example, when the mayor is talking to a crowd or on a TV show, where some of it's interpreted, but none of it's subtitled. Or when the scientists are talking to other scientists, then that would make sense for those scenes to be subtitled or to be translated. But because there's no groundwork as to why it's not being translated, it just becomes a frustrating mess. So you have to really just watch what you're seeing and hopefully understand what's going on. Now, some of the things that were going on in the city is being interpreted and translated by Francis McDormand in the film, which, fine, that's fine. But the main plot's on that island, and it would have been really nice to actually know exactly what Atari is saying and going through. Seeing this and going, I don't know if I should care about this kid or not, because the way he is talking, just by his sound and the way that he is saying it, seems more abrasive. Again, that's because I'm not into the culture of Japanese people than I would say you are or most people are. But that's what I'm getting out of it. So I'm like, seeing this and going, why should I care about this kid? And the movie just gives me nothing. This would seem like, to me, a step down from the animation from a Fantastic Mr. Fox. Fantastic Mr. Fox had, I think, very good stop-motion animation. It was very quirky in its way, but it was very charming. This film, I just didn't have that charm that I was looking for when it comes to Wes Anderson. And it's kind of hard to describe Wes Anderson's, I would say, charm. But Fantastic Mr. Fox had it. I think that story worked well with it. I don't think the way that the film looks, animates, or the way that Wes Anderson does his films really helps with the story that's being told. This seems like something that should be a little more harsher, I would say. I'm not saying, like, Grave of the Fireflies harsh, but maybe, like, Princess Mononoke harsh. Maybe a little more dramatic. Maybe a little more serious. I just don't think it really helped the way that the style was in this film with the story.
Overall, I think the plot was just kind of bog standard for sort of a journey to liberation, sort of a movie plot line and everything, which it's not bad, but it's not extraordinary either, so... there's that, but I think really just the odd decision to leave the subtitling only to pivotal moments on the major city of Megasaki versus Trash Island, where most of the movie plays out, I feel it just leaves out so much context, and it just carries a lot of important plot points and everything. And even now, just thinking on it, it just baffles the hell out of me, because I'm just kind of like... Why would you bury some of these important moments that Atari is having with these dogs and everything? And just, it's just very, very strange. I just don't know why the decision was made to do that. But again, it's kind of one of those things that I've just sort of put in the back of my mind of, it's Wes Anderson. He's weird. He's quirky. That's just how he does things. I don't know why, but... Sure, whatever.
I can understand why you would say that in when you only have, I think, you've only seen one of his films, right, which is The French Dispatch last year, correct?
Yeah, I did a while ago end up watching The Royal Tenenbaums because just The French Dispatch was interesting enough. I was like, yeah, let me go explore some of his other work.
Okay, so you've got a little bit of experience. It's not... that his stuff is weird and he does things for, like, flippant reasons. There is a deliberateness to why he shoots and he does the things the way he does. It just seems like this film was basically, I want to make a weird film set in Japan. It's just what it kind of felt like in this movie. And it just, to me, it did not work. There's a lot to what I like about Wes Anderson that is not in this movie, and that's the quirky humor, some good music as well. I don't even like the way it's shot. I don't even like the way it looks. Like, I just don't think it really is an interesting looking film, which is like almost a cardinal sin when it comes to Wes Anderson. Like, you cannot like his films, and that's fine, but you have to admit that there's a visual panache to it that is very unique, that belongs to him. And I just don't think this was here in this film, even compared to Fantastic Mr. Fox. Like, Fantastic Mr. Fox felt like a Wes Anderson film. This just felt like a weird offshoot of something that he would do. It doesn't feel like a film of his, except for how, like, the scenes are done. Like, it's done with the characters staring at the camera a lot, or like something like that. That's like the only thing that really would show me that, oh, Wes Anderson did this. Let's get to the voice performances. I didn't like Bryan Cranston as the main dog in this movie. I understand, like, the other actors are just regulars of Wes Anderson, like Bill Murray, Edward Norton, Bob Balaban, Francis McDormand. Like, they're regulars, so I get that. I don't like Bryan Cranston as the voice of Chief. Either he's not gruff enough, or when it's time to get a little comedic, he's kind of dry, which is very unlike Bryan Cranston. Like, Bryan Cranston is not only a very good actor, but if you've seen, like, him in Malcolm in the Middle, or if you've seen him in interviews, he's a very funny guy. It just seemed like he was bored throughout this movie.
I kind of had the same opinion. It was just, Chief is supposed to be sort of like this real gruff, hardened dog and everything, and just, it just seemed like sort of slight standoffishness. It didn't have the gruffness behind it, which was, for me, it was just like, the performance could have been a little bit more gruffer to kind of emphasize the point of, hey, I'm a street dog, just leave me the hell alone. I just didn't get that. It was just kind of more, hey, I'm just slightly grumpy, just leave me alone.
Yeah. Like, you get the sense of this dog that he is hard-bitten, went through a lot of hard times, had to survive on his own. So you'd expect something to be a lot more rough, a lot more, like, very harsh. And Cranston doesn't do this in this movie. He just, I think you said, he's just standoffish, aloof, and is like, whatever, I don't care. That seems to be his thing in this movie. And I thought, as the main character, it just didn't work with the way he portrayed this character. Cranston is a good actor. He can do good roles. Yeah, he just didn't seem very engaged in this movie. The way that Anderson does his films is a lot of the actors are toned down, except for specific circumstances. And this seemed way too toned down.
I do think it's interesting that there are some moments that it goes from stop motion into an animated style, which can be a little bit jarring, especially like when you've got a lot of action and movement going around, because like there's some moments where just something will happen, like a fight's gonna kick off, and then all of a sudden it just goes and cuts away to like an animated sequence of something going on in another place, another scene. And I saw this during the French Dispatch, and it was just kind of like, okay, well, kind of weird when you've got this unique stop motion animation style to, you know, just suddenly cut away to like a hand animation and cartoonish like style for a certain thing to happen. And it was just one of those things of, if you're gonna go for a unique animation, just go whole hog on it. Don't cut away from it. So I felt that was a little bit of a weird choice, but again, I mean, I'm sort of chalking this up to just Wes Anderson's quirky style.
I kind of understood it. I do agree with you in a lot of ways. If you were going to go that way in certain circumstances, go all the way. But I think he did the animated versions only when it's like a TV show, or it's like like on a radar screen or something like that. But I think it would have worked if it would have blended well with the animation that was present, or that was the main part of it. And I would agree with you that it doesn't fit very well, but I think it's also because the main animation to me didn't fit very well either. I don't think that the way that the film looks really grabbed me either. I didn't get your opinion on that. What did you think of the animation itself throughout the entire film, like for the main parts?
For the main stop motion stuff, it mostly seemed fine, but you have the fights. That's where it looks a little bit sloppy in my opinion, because like you have just generally really smooth stop motion animation, but when a fight happens, it just looks like things slow down and you can kind of see things becoming less fluid, especially like some of the bigger fights. It's just kind of the cartoon style, like giant dust ball with just random hands and limbs being shown and stuff like that. And it's just like, I get it. I mean, this is the style it's trying to evoke is reminiscent of like vintage cartoons and everything, but at the same time, it's just like, it just looks like the animation got slowed down to make this fight happen. It was one of those things that just felt a little bit off on the animation for me, but that's kind of personally what I thought about it.
I think it really just matters, anything specific with the animation, it just matters if you are engaged with it and charmed with it. Like, even if it is a little weird and quaint, if you don't buy into it, you're going to poke a whole lot of holes. And I know a lot of people who watched a movie called Anomalisa. I really liked Anomalisa, but it's a stop-motion movie with puppets about, well, about an adult relationship. And a lot of people that didn't like and complained to how weird the animation looked. But it just matters what the director does with that animation and why. The question I would have with Wes Anderson's decision on this is, why did you do it like this? What exactly did you see in this that would have helped the story along? And in this, I don't see what he could have gotten out of this type of animation. I probably would have thought this would have been better computer animated or even maybe hand-drawn. But I'm thinking more along the lines of like either a Studio Ghibli or a Watership Down kind of animation, which may have been a little too serious for that end. But I guess my issue really is I don't like the animation at all in this movie, whether it's the main animation or the extras that are in there to add a little flavor to it. I didn't like any of it, to be perfectly honest. A question for you. What did you think of the interpretation of Japan based on Wes Anderson's eye on this? and the types of music that he used in the film. Was it trying to evoke some kind of specific type of movies from Japan? What do you think?
I think it was almost sort of like an 80s cyberpunk interpretation of a distant future Japan. At least that's what it felt like to me. And for anyone who's not familiar of the origins of cyberpunk, it was during the Japanese bubble economy phase back in the 80s. And when you had news channels basically fear-mongering that Japan was going to basically take over the world and everyone better learn to speak Japanese or else, sort of a thing. So yeah, it just had kind of like a vibe of like 80s cyberpunk Japan, especially with the main city being called Megasaki, which I presume is just a hyper city that's just sort of loosely based around the actual city of Nagasaki, Japan. So that was kind of the vibe that I got out of the setting.
The interesting thing that I got out of it too was the music. There's a reason why, because it just felt like old music that you would hear from like the old Godzilla movies. Did you get that feeling too, or am I off on that?
There was definitely kind of like an old school monster movie vibe for the music selection.
Okay.
So I can definitely see where you would probably see where that would be evoked.
Again, it just doesn't fit with the rest of the film. Like, I really just did not understand exactly the aesthetics and the music involved in all this. Like, I'm actually kind of curious as to what his thought process was on that. Final thoughts on Isle of Dogs. This might be my second Wes Anderson film I don't like. I didn't like The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou, and I don't like this one either. This seems like there was a mix between the tone of the film, the animation, and the story, and nothing gelled for me in this one. The performance specifically of Bryan Cranston was off, and the decision to not translate not do subtitles for any of the Japanese speakers, unless interpreted in a specific circumstance, was an odd move that just did not work. I will echo a lot of things with you too. I really wasn't impressed with the animation very much, and just the feel of the film just felt really off with the story it was trying to say. I'm going to give this 1.5 out of 5 stars. I am pretty disappointed by this movie, and I'm actually kind of stunned with the ratings that this is getting. This is a very loved Wes Anderson film, and I kind of don't get it. And I would love to hear what everyone's thoughts of this movie is, but I just came out of this pretty nonplussed and being like, I don't get this at all. I'm not feeling any of this. So 1.5 out of 5 stars for me for Isle of Dogs. I would best avoid this.
I think for me, it's probably going to sit at probably about a 20%, but wow, Mostly it's just because of the fact that just I feel that the artistic decision to leave off the subtitles during the Garbage Island stuff with Atari omits so much context that I feel would have been very important to have. Even if the dogs don't technically understand Japanese, I just feel that a lot of the impassioned moments that Atari has during Garbage Island would have been important for the viewer to have, but for some reason it's just artistic interpretation, so we're not subtitling this. For me, that's a little bit of a baffling decision. I just don't know why that's just the decision that was set in stone, and it's just a bit of a shame because maybe it's just because of the fact that just I do have a bit of an understanding of Japanese that I feel that just it's just a damn shame to have so much context being lost, but at the same time, just the animation's okay. It looks a little bit off on some moments with the stop motion stuff, and then like we mentioned with the voice acting, a lot of the voices are okay, but the one that should have been better was a Chief's portrayal by Bryan Cranston. Just it comes off as more aloof instead of just this real hardened stray dog, and It just kind of bums me out because I thought the premise of the movie was good, but just with all the flaws, it just makes it so hard for me to just really feel impassioned to recommend it to people.
Yeah, I'm not saying that. I just want to reiterate, I'm not saying that the animation itself is bad. I just don't think it fits with the rest of the film and with the style that it's going for. I end up agreeing with you a lot with your stances on this.
All in all, just as said, just I like the premise of it and everything, but I just wish that execution-wise, it was a little bit better.
I definitely agree with that. 1.5 out of 5 for me, 20% for 0 on Isle of Dogs. That sucks. that's pretty disappointing. I actually was looking forward to this and didn't like it, unfortunately.